Hey guys, welcome back to 5 Live here on KTLA. Exciting day for those of you who love sports, specifically hockey. We have, first of all, I've gotten out of my producer pod. I'm here now on the desk. Kind of feels like getting out of the penalty box, which is important because our guest today, Joe Bartnick, host of the Puck Off podcast. Thanks for being here, Joe.
Hey, thanks for having me, Scott. Long time. Used to be our producer at Puck Off. You were one of the best producers. You knew your sports. Everybody else is like, hockey, I don't know, I want to talk about comic books.
Right.
You're like, let's talk some puck.
Yeah, so the interesting thing is, before I was a producer here, and one of the other gigs I had was producing at the Sideshow Network, which had a ton of comedic talent, yourself included.
Oh,
and you guys had the Puck Off podcast, which was one of the few ones that talks sports. A lot of podcasts back then, because this is now 6 years ago, so 2012 was when you guys started, right?
Right, this is our 6 year anniversary this week.
Yeah, so talk to me about like what the podcasting space looked like when you started. What was that world like? Now everyone knows what podcasts are. They follow them, they listen to 100. It's like, oh, have you heard the newest one? And you're like, there's 1,000. But back then, not so many.
Right, back then we were like the only people podcasting hockey.
Yeah.
So we had a huge audience. Now it's like every team has 15 of their own podcasts. But we did it, we first Frazer came to the great Frazer Smith, my partner, legendary DJ. Everyone here knows comedy and DJing, knows Frazer. He came to me and goes, hey, they want to do a podcast about hockey, and do you want to do it? I said, absolutely. So the first year was basically us just bringing our comedy friends in, and they got some famous actors, just musicians, all these people talking hockey. But after 10 minutes, I would get these people like, you know, everyone watches hockey in the postseason.
Yeah.
So in 3 weeks, all of a sudden we're talking about chili dogs in Chicago with John Hawk as opposed to the Blackhawks.
Right.
And then come playoff time, it got interesting, so we started talking about the playoffs.
Mm-hmm.
Then it became a real hockey podcast. And then people want to hear real hockey. And then in the summer, like, what did we do? So we're like, well, let's just talk about, like, our favorite goalies of all time or our favorite teams of all time. We call it summer programming. And no one was doing the hockey podcast in the summer, especially 6 years ago.
Yeah.
That's how we built an audience and a fan base, and that's 6 years later, we've never missed a week.
I was going to say, so we're celebrating the sixth year now. This is the sixth year. You just had on Wednesday, right? The episode dropped?
Well, actually, it was season 5, week 52 dropped yesterday.
Oh, okay.
So six, and then episode 1 will be next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday. So the starting, so because the hockey season just started
last night. Yes.
Okay. So in my experience, hockey fans are 1, super knowledgeable, 2, super passionate. How has it been existing in that space where, especially now, anyone can reach out and say, hey, you guys don't know what you're talking about. Hey, our team's great. You got to like give us more love. What has that been like to deal with kind of the like very focused, singular vision hockey fan kind of out now in the internet?
Well, it's a lot of fun because there's so much passion and so much knowledge. But I personally have a lot of haters.
You have haters.
Yeah, I do.
Who's a hater out here? Come on. Joe? You can't hate Joe. That's ridiculous.
If we were doing this show in Philadelphia, they'd cut the power right now.
Really?
Yeah, because I'm a Penguins fan and Flyer fans. I mean, that's the biggest rival. One of the biggest rivalries in sports. It's like Yankees, Red Sox.
Yeah.
And just people come out of the woodwork because we have Sidney Crosby and Evgeny Malkin. But basically, we're pro every team except I don't like the Flyers.
So
other than that, we're a perfect team because, you know, Kings are our mistress team because Frazier's a Red Wings fan.
Right.
But we also give a lot of love to the Ducks. We're just hockey for everybody.
So for those of you who don't know, Joe is from the Pittsburgh area. That's where he grew up. And so big time Pittsburgh fan, as you're explaining about the Flyers and that kind of rivalry. How much can people expect, though, to get that inside information? Because I assume you still have people back in Pittsburgh who are kind of feeding you all the time about what's going on with the team.
Oh, absolutely. And I do a lot of morning radio in Pittsburgh. So I have little pockets of information people everywhere. So we can keep up on the latest news and the rumors. And that's what hockey fans live for.
Yeah.
Is the rumors and who might be traded, who might not be traded, and just the inside dirt. So we do a lot on the show.
Now, the interesting thing is that, Joe, before you were doing just kind of this podcast, though, your background's in comedy. And that is a kind of a whole different beast. So can you kind of walk me through how you combined your comedy career? By the way, continually we can see you on the road opening for the great Bill Burr, right? You used to go out on the road with him?
Yes, still do. We're playing Madison Square Garden in the middle of November, but just Friday night we played the LA Forum, the Fabulous Forum.
Sold out, right?
He sold it out.
Yeah. So Joe, like I said, his background's in comedy. Talk to me about what it's like to be a comic and kind of how you got interested in that, and then how did you get to this point where now these two loves have come together? Because that's the best part about Puck Off. It's hockey, but it's also two comics kind of riffing and makes it fun and interesting.
That's the whole point of the podcast, is to make hockey entertaining and fun. And that's a lot of people say, you know, I don't even like hockey, but we love the podcast because you and Frazer are funny on it. I just always wanted to do comedy my whole life. I wanted to be Johnny Carson or Dave Letterman or Dennis Miller or Rodney Dangerfield. Oh. And then Eddie Murphy Delirious was like our Beatlemania. Mm-hmm. It was like our Ed Sullivan. It was like, oh my God, you don't have to wear a suit and tie and try to be on television and be, you can wear a red leather outfit.
You don't have
outfit.
To try and wear a suit and tie, but when Joe showed up here, he came in looking so fresh and so fly. I had to go get this out of the car. I had to go get a sports coat. But anyway, so.
This is a newscast. This isn't a late comedy night show.
Fair enough. Yeah. You look great. So
thank you.
So you growing up, you love Eddie Murphy.
Yes.
What's it like the first time you go get on stage?
I didn't get a laugh for maybe five tries.
And how did that feel?
It felt like, well, I'm hilarious. I'm still going to do this. you have to have that in you.
Yeah. So
if you give up that easily, you're never going to do it.
Yeah. So the next thing that I remember when you and I used to work together was at that time you had done a lot of work with the famous Lisa Lampanelli.
Yes.
Now talk about somebody who can really bring a house down and also divide an audience. What's it like when you go on the road with somebody of that level? And it's your job to make sure that the crowd is like super ready to go, but also you're trying to kill yourself. You're trying right. to bring the house down yourself.
Well, you just do your show. You know, Lisa or Bill or whoever picks you to open because they like you.
Right.
And then when you do your show, and if anything, you know, Bill is like, he wants me to take chances. He wants me to be a comedian because he's such the comics comic, even though he's loved around the world. He's probably the number one. He has the belt right now, I believe, for comedy.
Well, and into that regard, what's it like, so you said with Bill going out there, does he tell you like, hey, I want you to kill, because there's a lot of, for people who don't know, there's a lot of, in comedy, some comics who don't want to follow someone who is great. But Bill is so great, does he tell you, hey, you better bring the house down so that I can up my game? Or does he say, just do whatever you want, doesn't matter, I'll crush either way?
He has faith in me that I'm going to crush, because in my own personal, I'm not going to not try to do good.
Okay.
Yeah. But he wants me to take chances and have fun, because the more you relax and have fun, you've done comedy, the more you kill.
Yeah.
And that's what he wants. And he brings what he thinks are his favorite comics and the best people he can bring, because he always says no William and Marys. He doesn't schedule any.
Explain that to me.
Any cupcakes on the road. You know how in college football,
yeah,
Notre Dame will play Texas, but then they'll play like the Little Sisters of the Poor.
Right, yes.
He doesn't schedule Little Sisters of the Poor.
Right, it's only the best, only big bringers, just
right.
knock it out. So thinking about that, the first time you did comedy, no laughs for five, like, you know, that first feeling.
Yeah, I'm not going to recount what I said, but one comic who was there goes, oh, you got a couple laughs. I didn't hear them.
Okay. Yeah, it's a rough feeling. If you've never kind of, here's the way I explain it to people. If you've been at a party and you've told a story, and for whatever reason, that story, normally everyone goes, oh, that was such a funny tale. Well, thanks for telling it. And you finish the story and people just kind of look at you like, okay. That's what it feels like when you're on stage and a joke doesn't hit, right? That's the way I explain it.
Right.
And so you go from like that original feeling of doing that years ago, and all of a sudden you're on Madison Square Garden, you're at the Forum. Did you ever think in your wildest dreams that that was the trajectory that would happen?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, I
would. For a second, I thought you were going to go, absolutely. Me? Yes, absolutely.
Well, I remember like when I was 17, 18, I go into comedy clubs in Pittsburgh, and I thought, all I want to do is be the host. He comes up, tells a couple topical jokes. He gets off, you know, I thought he's a professional comic, he makes a great living. I didn't know he's making like $25 a set and two drinks.
Yeah.
So, you know, everything has just been a bonus. I just love telling jokes, writing a joke, going on stage, being funny, hopefully. I just love that whole aspect. That's all I love about it.
So, to bring it back to the hockey component though, what city, when you go, do you know, you said you've got a lot of haters out there, what city do you know when they hear your name, they're like, oh, it's this guy who loves Pittsburgh.
In all honesty, the comedy fans in Philadelphia love me.
Oh, great.
Because it's like a whole different animal. It's like the people who sit in their basement in send me death threats about the Flyers. They're not the people who think I'm cool and come out and go to see comedy shows.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of two different things. It actually upsets people because so many people are my Twitter fans or Facebook friends wanting to be like, why do you keep putting hockey on? Because then half of them are for the hockey and don't think I'm a funny comic. So it's a give or take.
So the hockey season started. We're here in Los Angeles. First and foremost, what's the prediction? How are the Kings look to you this season?
I think the Kings make the playoffs. I think they're the third best team in the Pacific.
Okay. And now down the freeway,
yes.
How are the Ducks looking?
I picked the Ducks fourth, and it was very close to picking them third because I'm a little concerned about Dusty Brown's broken finger.
Okay. And now you're a Pittsburgh guy.
Yes.
Last year, the Washington Capitals finally have achieved what no one thought could be possible. They won the Stanley Cup. What do you see kind of this year? Who's your pick to go to the Stanley Cup Finals? And who is your pick to raise the cup? Has it not been released? Do you like do something in the podcast now where it's like you don't?
We actually didn't pick a favorite. We didn't pick our winners yet this year because it's almost like then it changes a little bit. So that's almost like for national media people.
Okay.
We don't really do that. We do when the playoffs start.
Okay.
But I will say I'm going to pick Pittsburgh and Winnipeg.
Pittsburgh and Winnipeg.
Yes.
Okay.
The Winnipeg Jets, I won't be a homer. I'm going to pick the Winnipeg Jets.
Okay. I was going to say, are you picking Pittsburgh as a homer though?
No, because they won it the 2 years prior. I don't think the Capitals are going to repeat, and I like what the Penguins have done. And Sidney Crosby and Evgeny Malkin are rested. They had a whole summer to rest, and they're angry.
Yeah. Here's my question though. This is one of my fun ones. Say someone's never been to a hockey game. A lot of times. Place like Los Angeles or even down in Anaheim, you might kind of go because your work has tickets or somebody you know has tickets. What should a hockey fan going to an arena for the first time kind of look for to enjoy the experience as much as they can from the hockey insider? Like, do you try and follow the puck? Are you just trying to like take in the scene? Should because a hockey game has an energy unlike kind of any game you've ever been to. So what do you tell someone for their first time?
The first time you go, I would actually say spend the money, get the best tickets you can, get as close as you can, because you will be amazed. It's so fast and you can see everything away from the puck. I think, which is amazing, just a little violence in the corner,
mm-hmm.
and the speed of the game, and you see how they are so adept with their hands at playing the puck with their sticks, and just what they can do, and then you see how they're on skates and they do it.
Yeah.
The hand-eye coordination and the speed of the game, the closer you get, is just, oh my God. Because when you're watching it from afar, you think it's almost like it's a video game. Like, oh, they can do that. And when you're up close, you can see, that's a human being doing all that at 1,000 miles an hour.
Okay, then what's harder, telling jokes in front of a sold-out crowd at Madison Square Garden, or do you think playing in the NHL? Which do you think would be harder?
Oh, playing in the NHL. 100%.
You heard it there first. The athletes get the... Because, as a comedian or a performer, you always think like, oh, I wish I could be a professional athlete. And then you see professional athletes trying to do comedy. So that it's probably easier to transition from comedy into... I mean, from professional sports into comedy than like we put you on some skates and put you out there.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, my skating is... I have sweet hands. I can't skate worth a lick.
Okay, so tell everyone where you can find the podcast, Puck Off, as you see behind us.
Yes.
How people can get it, where they can find you.
Puck Off is on the All Things Comedy Network, and it's on iTunes and SoundCloud.
Okay, and this weekend, so we'll air this, and it'll be online for this weekend. You're here in Los Angeles
this
performing?
This weekend I'm at the Haha Cafe, and also at the Comedy Store on Friday night.
And speaking of the Comedy Store, that's where you can always find your legendary co-host, Frazer Smith.
Yes.
Always out there. He's always around. If you've never been to the Comedy Store on the Sunset Strip, check it out. You're always there kind of hanging out anyway if somebody comes through.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm in town, I like to perform there. I perform there at least once or twice a week.
Yeah. All right, so, Joe, thanks so much for coming on 5 Live.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It.
So
yeah.
great to see
it's
you again.
Good to see you. It's a switch up. We got to put on our jackets, which is always fun. If you're in town, see him this weekend at the Ha Ha Comedy Club. If not, find Puck Off wherever you get your podcasts. And season 6, here we go.
Fantastic. Thanks for having me.
Thanks. We'll be right back after this.